Welcome to an enlightening podcast from IslamPodcasts.com. We encourage our listeners to please comment and let us know how we can grow in our knowledge to better serve our community. Please remind your family and friends to also visit IslamPodcasts.com for engaging discussions on current events, Islamic guidance, Quran, tafsir, Seerah, and much more.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد إن شاء الله in today's Seerah session we will cover Ghazwah Bani Al-Mustaliq and which is also called Ghazwah Muraisi and besides that some of the treacherous role by the Munafiqeen that included their role in the incident of slander against Aisha radiallahu anha. So we'll start from where we left off last week. We covered Ghazwat al-Qurayda and also the aftermath of that. After Ghazwat al-Qurayda, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got the news on the second of the Sha'ban. This is the fifth year of the Hijrah, fifth year of the Hijrah, and Bani al-Mustaliq al-Harith bin Dira. This was the sixth year of Hijrah, and the chief of Bani al-Mustaliq al-Harith bin Dira, he was mobilizing the army to attack the Muslims in Medina. And besides Bani al-Mustaliq, he was able to get some of the Arab tribes around the Medina who were going to attack Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam heard about that, he sent Buraida bin al-Hasib al-Aslami to verify this report. And he went and he had some words over there with the tribe and confirmed his intention. He talked to the leader, Al-Harith bin Dirar. And so he actually sent somebody to observe Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's position and the Muslim's position. But he was captured and he was killed. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prepared the army to go against Bani al-Mustaliq because they were going to attack, and they sent their person to spy on the Muslims as well. And before Rasulullah was leaving, as his usual way of leaving somebody behind as the ruler, Rasulullah says, left Zayd bin Haritha. Zayd bin Haritha, and we'll talk a little bit about him as well today. He was a freed slave as well as he was referred as an adopted son of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as well. So he left him as the one who was the caretaker of the Medina behind him. And he gave one of the flags of the immigrants, to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and the flag of the Ansar was given to Sa'ad bin Ubada radiallahu anhu. And now the army of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was stationed to the place which is called Muraisi. This is why this is also called Ghazwat Muraisi. The fight started, and the arrows were shot, and quite a bit of a battle happened. Muslims had the upper hand in that battle, and Muslim won the battle, and a lot of booty of spoil of war. The booty of war was collected, and the captives were gathered, and also the daughter of the leader of Bani al-Mustaliq, Bani Mustaliq's daughter Juwayriya, radiallahu anha, the one who became the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam later on, she came as a captive as well, and she came as a captive, and she was became a captive to one of the Ansars. And Juwayriya radiallahu anha, at that time she did the there's a thing called makatib, which is you can write, he did the kitab, that write agreement that after paying certain amount of money, you will be freed. So she did that. And then as the report mentions, that she went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked for helping her out for getting her freed. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam offered her that she can be, she can get something better also, which was he freed her as well as he offered her in his marriage, and she accepted the proposal. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam married Juwayriya. And upon Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam married to Juwayriya, radiallahu anha, the Sahaba, they freed about 100 people who came as the prisoners. And 100 people were freed because they all considered as now the in-laws of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Aisha radiallahu anha, as some of the reports talk about that, when she saw Juwayriya radiallahu anha the first time, she right away she saw the beauty of Juwayriya and she was jealous. But even her, she says she hasn't seen a woman, so blessed woman for her people, because of the number of people were freed just because of her marrying Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this ghazwa, even though itself does not seem to be from the military perspective as too much of big of a deal, but there are other incidents that happen around Ghazwat al-Mustaliq were of great interest. There was when the armies were stationed, and one of the Sahabi who was an ally with from the Ghaffar, the tribe of the Ghaffar, and he was an ally of the Muhajirin, and one of the Sahabi who was an ally of Khazraj, they were trying to get the water, and while they were hustling for water, somehow they got into an argument and they started calling each other's allies to fight on their behalf, and that was a troublesome issue that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was among them. And these Sahaba, they started calling their allies to fight with each other for a minor thing, as when they were getting water and they had some heated argument, and they were about to start fighting with each other. And when this situation came up, Abdullah bin Ubai bin Salul, the head of the Munafiqeen, the head of the hypocrites, he showed his hypocrisy actually here. And we talked about his hypocrisy in the past also, that how he showed his hypocrisy in after Badr and in Ghazwatul Uhud and Ghazwatul Ahzab. And whenever he was getting chances, he was involved in hurting the Muslims. But now when this incident happened, that the Muslims would start calling each other to fight on Ansar and Muhajirin were about to fight with each other because of this incident. Now he found a chance to cause some sort of trouble between the Muslims. And he said some certain statements, and that those statements can included, like he said, referring to the Muslims as they have outnumbered and shared us our land. If you fatten your dog, it will eat you. And similarly, later on, at one incident, he even referred to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the disgraced one. And he said that the most after we will go back to Medina after this battle, the most honorable will expel the disgraced out of the Medina. And when this report was heard by one of the young Sahabi, he went to his uncle and he told his uncle about what Abdullah bin Ubay was talking about. And now, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told about this, and Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu was sitting there, Umar's response was that he said that, Ya Rasulullah, give the permission to Abbad bin Bashar, and he will go and kill Abdullah bin Ubay. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu about this, that he said that if he does this action, then the people would say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is killing his own companions. So look, we have to understand this idea of these munafiqeen and how to treat with the, how to deal with the munafiqeen as well. Or munafiqeen means hypocrites. First of all, to understand, when we are talking about hypocrites or munafiqeen, these are the people who are kuffar in their heart. They did not accept Islam, but in the face value, they come out and they show themselves as they have accepted Islam and they were Muslims. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has showed us that how to deal with these kind of personalities. First of all, us as a normal human being, we do not know, we cannot say that what is the matter of the heart of the people, right? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given this kind of information from the wahi from Allah azza wa jal, that who was the really munafiq and who was not. But in our case, we cannot say anything about what's in the hearts of the people. We can only talk about the actions undertaken by a person, whether the action is according to Islam or not. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he showed us from the actions that even when it comes to munafiqeen, and he was given the from the wahi, who was a munafiq, but he showed to the people how to deal with them. And this is why he said, the people will say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is killing his own companions if he would have killed Abdullah bin Ubai. So now, and that's what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and he left it there. But when Abdullah bin Ubai bin Salul, he found out about that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has found out about his statement, then he went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he swore that he never said this. And that young man, a child, he must have misheard Abdullah bin Ubay bin Salul. And because he swore, and that's enough. So the idea is this, like, when somebody comes and reports something about anyone, that has to be proven. You cannot just accuse anyone about something that fulan person has said something or done something and you don't have any proof. So you have to prove it. Even in the case of Abdullah bin Ubay, the hypocrite, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not punish him just based on what he said. And the reports actually talk about that incident that later on, the Sahaba, like Sa'ad bin Mu'ad, and he got up and he said, Rasulullah, allow me to kill him. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not allow any of them. And when Usayd bin Hudayr was told about this, his response was that, Ya Rasulullah, you are the honorable one and he is the disgraced one. And he mentioned that the reason that he is acting like this because Abdullah bin Ubay, that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to Medina and he became the ruler of the Medina, right before that, the people of Medina, they were preparing a crown for him and he was about to become the king of Medina. But when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam came and he became the ruler, for him, it was as if a coup has happened against him, and he kept a grudge until he actually died, and he died in the state of nifaq. But when we are talking about, so he mentioned why he was acting like this. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam let it go. But this was his son also. Abdullah bin Ubay's son, his name was Abdullah as well, but he was a good Muslim, and when he heard about that and he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked, Ya Rasulullah, that he said he's heard that his father would be killed, and he said like this, if his father would be killed, and he said, you know that I am the most merciful and good towards my father, and if I find out that somebody else would have killed my father and he would be walking on the earth, that would have been very painful for me to see the killer of my father. It's better for me that you order me and I will go ahead and kill my father. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that this is not Rasulullah's intent, and that was let go at that time. But when the Sahaba, when they were about to fight with each other, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he left from he took the army and he left from there, because but normally Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to not leave at that time, but he left because he wanted to take the minds of the Sahaba away from this kind of a situation they got involved in. And they continued to walk the whole day and the next day, the whole night, and even the part of the next day was passed, and they continued to walk. And they walked so much that they got tired, and they were distracted from the situation they were getting involved into, and they did not talk about the situation. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was able to divert the attention of the Sahaba. See, there are two ways of doing this, right? One is, of course, the aqidah is enough for us to remember that these kind of asabiyya kind of a thoughts, meaning that my tribe is better than your tribe, or I am better than you, they can be taken care of. The aqidah, just reminding that this is from the jahiliya thoughts. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did that among the Sahaba. We have seen that in other situations as well. But besides that, the situation that was heating up, and the Munafiqeen, they were playing their role to make the Muslims fight with each other. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to take that anger away from them and divert this attention, and they can think about the situation with a clear mind rather than talking to each other while they were still angry. So this is how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took care of this sensitive situation. And we will see that how this very same Munafiq Abdullah bin Ubay bin Salul was taken care of later on in another situation that came up because of, during the very same incident that we are talking about, which was the Ghazwah, which was during the Ghazwah al-Bani Mustalaq. Now, besides that, there's another incident that happened around the same time. Was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he married Zainab radiallahu anha, the wife, she was an ex-wife of her adopted son Zayd bin Haritha. Now, when this happened among the Arabs, there was a known thing that if you adopt somebody, adopt a child, that becomes your child, and you even call him by your, give your name as the father's name. As a matter of fact, one of the hadith reported by Ibn Umar that talks about this, that he says about the Anna Zayd ibn Haritha, Mawla Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma kunna nadu'uhu illa Zayd ibn Muhammad. حَتَّى نَزَلَ الْقُرْآنُ وَدُعُهُمْ لِأَبَائِهِمْ هُوَ أَقْصَتُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. That says that we used to call Zayd ibn Haritha, the freed slave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, except by the name Zayd bin Muhammad, until this ayah was revealed. And this ayah was in Surah Al-Ahzab. And that ayah, the meaning of the ayah, وَدُعُهُمْ لِأَبَائِهِمْ هُوَ أَقْصَتُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, means call them, means referring to adopted sons, by the names of their fathers. That is more than just in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So after this ayah was revealed, they started calling Zayd ibn Haritha. Before that, they used to call him as Zayd ibn Muhammad. So now, among the Arabs at the time, they used to refer them as adopted son, as a real son, and actually used to even inherit. Now, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married the wife of the wife who was divorced by Zayd, that became an issue among the Arabs, and especially the Munafiqeen. They started rubbing this in the face of the Muslims. And one common thing that we find about this incident and the other incident of the slander against the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is this, that kuffar, they realized that even though Muslims were not the one who had a lot of material power or strength, but they realize that they cannot beat them in the battlefield. At the same time, they also understood that the Muslims were achieving all the victories were not because of the material power, rather because of the moral strength and the belief in Allah Azza wa Jal and their characters. So now, during this battle and later on, the kuffar, they started using more of started accusations against the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the sahaba around him and the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that it was one of the incidents from the beginning, or one of the beginning incidents that was used against like that against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the sahaba. And in this case, what they did was they started saying that how can Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam marry? And this is again the Munafiqeen, they started off, and even until today, many of these incidents are used by, especially by Orientalists, the one who studied the deen of Islam, and then they try to use the deen against the Muslim. And Orientalists are the one who now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very clearly mentioned that just because somebody is adopted, he does not make him your son. And Allah Azza wa Jal says, "Ma kana Muhammad aba ahadin min rijalikum walakinna Rasulullah wa khataman nabiyyin wa kana Allahu bi kulli shay'in 'alima." Muhammad is not the father of any one of your men, but he is the messenger of Allah and last of the prophets, and ever is Allah of all things knowing. And other place in Surah Al-Ahzab also, the one that I mentioned, that ayah, "Udu'uhum li'abahim wa aqsur 'inda Allah," is referring to the very same incident of Zayd ibn Harith, actually. And the ayah, the one that says, "Call them by the names of the fathers," it is more just in the sight of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Fa'in lam ta'alamu abahum fa'ikhwanukum fi mawalikum." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "But if you do not know their fathers, then they are still your brothers in religion, and those interests to you." So this is how the the Islam looks at the issue of adoption. That look, just because you call somebody your son, it doesn't make him your real son. So from that perspective, sometimes people don't understand when somebody says that in Islam there is no concept of adoption. This is what it refers to, that you cannot just become a father of somebody even though he's not your father. But besides that, you can take care of the orphans or the one who are in needy. That's not a problem. But we cannot just refer to them just because you refer to them. Call them your son does not become your son. So that's a conceptual thing that we should remember. That's what it refers to whenever it talks about there is no adoption in Islam from that perspective. Okay, so that's one thing that they use against it. Other thing they use was, they also, Abdullah bin Ubai was one of the people who started saying as if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he actually liked Zainab, so he made Zayd divorce Zainab, and he married Zainab, radiallahu anha. And this is a very interesting thing. First of all, Zainab bint Jahash, she was the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered Zayd to marry Zainab, because he was his he was the one who was taking care of him, his freed slave, and until one point referred as adopted son, and he asked Zainab to marry Zayd. Zainab actually, radiallahu anha, she refused to, in the beginning, she refused to marry Zayd, because she, for her, she was of a higher status. She was married, she was a divorced woman from the Quraysh. She was of a higher status to go and marry a freed slave. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded, upon which she actually accepted to marry Zayd, and they were married. And after they were married, the things did not work out, and it ended up in divorce after a year or two. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam married Zainab after the son after Zayd, the divorce of Zainab, radiallahu anha. Now, the Orientalists and even the Munafiqeen at that time, they tried to make this as an issue to say bad things about the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also they said because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the fifth wife, Zainab was the fifth one, and the Quran put the maximum limit of four. So now they start saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is breaking the rules. While Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam kind of he was allowed to marry more than four wives. As we know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says also, Ya ayyuha nabi ittaqullah wa la tuti'al kafirin wal munafiqin inna allaha kana aliman hakima. O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, keep your duty to Allah and obey not the disbelievers and hypocrites. Verily Allah is ever all knower, all wise, meaning do not just because they are making accusations against you, do not do something against what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded him. Now, so this is when it comes to Zainab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed him, and we know that there are some of, within the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are some of the actions are allowed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while they were not allowed to others. That includes marrying more than four wives, which was actually later in his life, it was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was ordered that he is not allowed to marry any more wives at all. Besides the marriage, things like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was allowed to fast two consecutive days without breaking the fast, while the normal people among the Muslims, we are not allowed to do that. We have to break the fast to fast another day. Or things like it was an obligation on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to pray during a night or salat al-tahajjud, while for the Muslims, it's not an obligatory salah. So there are some of the actions which are specific to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the regular Muslims are not allowed to do that. And the marriage was one of them. The more than four wives was one of the actions that was allowed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that was about the Zayd and the Zainab radiallahu anhuma. And after that, when the Muslims were returning back from the battle of Bani Al-Mustaliq, and there's a long hadith actually that talks about the issue of the slandering affair or the ifk that Aisha radiallahu anha has reported, that is reported in Bukhari. So I'll try to summarize the hadith, and at least we can get some meaning out of it, inshallah, or lessons out of it. When Aisha radiallahu anha was returning back, and Aisha was one of the Ummahatul Mu'mineen whose name came up in the draws. Because whenever Rasulullah SAW used to go out for expeditions on a journey, he used to draw the lots, and whichever the wife's name would come out, he would take her with him. And when they were going for Ghazwatul Bani Al-Mustaliq, Aisha radiallahu anha's name came out, and she was with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, when they were returning back from Ghazwa, she was on one of the camels, and camel had, there's a thing called howdaj. Howdaj is a thing, it's like a small, if I call it a small cubicle thing that you put on top of the camel, and the women sit inside it. So it's covered, and the women are sitting inside. So Aisha was in the howdaj of on the camel, during those days they did not have like a bathrooms and toiletry like this the way we have today. So when Aisha radiallahu anha, she when the army was stationed, and she had to go for to take care of her the call of nature, and she moved away from the camel. And when she went there, she was returning back to the camel, and she found out that she lost the necklace that she borrowed from her sister. And because that was not her own necklace, it's not that it was expensive or something, but that was not her own necklace. So she went back, and she followed the track, and she was looking for the necklace. And while she was looking for it, and when she found the necklace, she came back. When she came back, she found that the army had already left. And the reason army left was, in general, the women at that time, they were light. They did not used to have too much to eat, as Aisha mentioned in the hadith. So those people, then the people who were carrying the Hawdaj, they did not feel the difference in the heaviness of the Hawdaj, and while they were lifting, and they put it over the camel at that time. And she said she was a young lady, and they did not realize, and that could be because of that. Too many people were carrying it, so they did not realize that she was not inside. Now, so they went, they left, and now she got tired over there, and she just fell asleep. Then Safwan bin Mu'attal, he was coming behind the army. And when he saw Aisha radiallahu anha sleeping there, and actually this incident was after the ahka, or ruling of the hijab, but when she was sleeping, he was able to see her, and he recognized her because he saw her before the ruling of the hijab came. So the only thing, as Aisha mentions, that Safwan bin al-Mu'attal said, when he saw Aisha, was "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un," and these are the only words he said to Aisha when he saw her, and until they were able to meet the army again. But the way he even took Aisha with her, he made his camel knelt down, and he got off, and he made Aisha radiallahu anha to get on the camel, and he walked the whole way. He was in the front of the camel, and he walked the whole way until they met the army. Now, what happened after that was, then the Aisha says, then whosoever was meant for destruction fell into destruction. Some people accused me falsely, and the leader of the false accuser was Abdullah bin Ubai bin Salul. Now, after they went back to Medina, Aisha radiallahu anha says she became ill. And she was ill for about a month. And she was not getting any news what's happening around. Because Abdullah ibn Ubay, he actually started accusing Safwan and Aisha radiallahu anhuma about bad conduct. That they have done something bad, and they accused both of them. Now, she was not aware of it, she was sick. The only thing she felt was that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not as usual kind as he used to be when she used to get sick. So, but he would greet and say, how is that girl? I did not know anything of what was going on till I recovered from my ailment. That's what Aisha says. And she said that she went out with Mistah. So she went out with her, and to answer the call of nature. They used to go away from the living habitant place, and when they were walking, Mustah, she tripped, and when she tripped, stumbled, she said. That Mustah bin Ruin. So when she said that, she cursed at Mustah. Mustah was her son. And Aisha said that you are saying a bad word. Why are you abusing a man who took part in the Badr? And we know that the people who participated in Badr, they have a very high status among the Sahaba even. And the reports talk about them as that their sins are forgiven. So now the mother goes that, didn't you hear what they said? Then she told Aisha mentioned that she told her the whole story about the accusations. Now, Aisha's sickness got aggravated by that. She returned home, and when Rasulullah ﷺ came to her, and he said, how is that girl? How is Aisha? And I requested him, Aisha said, I requested him to allow me to go to my parents. And because Aisha, she said that I wanted to then be sure of the news through them. And Rasulullah ﷺ allowed me, and I went to my parents and asked my mother, what are you people talking about? She said, "Oh, my daughter, don't worry much about this matter. By Allah, never is there a charming woman loved by her husband who has other wives, but the woman would forge false news about her." I said, "Subhanallah, are the people really talking of this matter?" That night, Aisha mentioned that she continued to cry and could not sleep until morning. In the morning, Allah's Messenger, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, called Ali bin Abi Talib and Usama bin Zayd. And he started asking about Aisha radiallahu anha. So Usama's response was, Usama bin Zayd, that what he knew of the good reputation of his wives, and added, meaning that that's the only thing he knows about the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, "Oh, Rasulullah, keep your wife. By Allah, we know nothing about her but good." So that was the response of Usama. But when it came to Ali radiallahu anhu, he did not say bad things about Aisha. Ali bin Abi Talib's response was, "Oh, Ya Rasulullah, Allah has not imposed restrictions on you. There are many women other than she, yet you may ask the women servant who will tell you the truth." Meaning, he said, if you really want to know the truth, go to the women servant. They will know more detail about even your wife. And Rasulullah s.a.w. went to Barira radiallahu anha and asked her. So Barira's response, he asked her, "Did you ever see anything which roused your suspicion about her?" And Barira said, "No, by Allah, who has sent you with the truth. I have never seen in her anything faulty except that she's a girl of immature age who sometimes sleeps and leaves the dough for the goats to eat." So that's the only thing she can think of, anything bad about Aisha, that she may fall asleep while the dough is there and goat will come and eat. On that day, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam got on the minbar and requested that somebody support him in punishing Abdullah bin Ubay bin Salul. Rasulullah sallam said, but he did not say the name there. He said like this, who will support me to punish that person who has hurt me by slandering the reputation of my family? By Allah, I know nothing about my family but good. And they have accused a person about whom I know nothing except good." And Safwan. "And he never entered my house except in my company." Sa'ad bin Mu'adh radiallahu anhu, he got up and he said, "Oh, Allah's messengers, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by Allah, I will relieve you from him if that man is from the tribe of the Aws, because Sa'ad bin Mu'adh was from Aws. Then we will chop off his head, and if he is from our brothers, Khazraj, then order us and we will fulfill your order." Meaning, whether it's from Aws or Khazraj, Sa'ad bin Mu'adh said, "We'll take care of him." Now, on that, Sa'ad bin Ubadah, radiallahu anhu, he was the chief of the Khazraj. And before this incident, the hadith says he was a pious man. Got up and motivated by his zeal for his tribe and said, "By Allah, you have told a lie. You cannot kill him and you will never be able to kill him." On that, Usaid ibn Hudayr got up and said to Sa'ad bin Ubadah, "By Allah, you are a liar. By Allah, we will kill him and you are a hypocrite, defending hypocrites." On this, the two tribes of Aws and Khazraj got excited and were about to fight each other. While Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was standing on the pulpit, he got down and quieted them till they became silent and kept quiet. On that day, Aisha is mentioning that I kept on weeping so much so that neither did my tears stop nor could I sleep. In the morning, my parents were with me and I had wept for two nights and a day till I thought my liver would burst from my weeping. While they were sitting with me and I was weeping, an Ansari woman asked my permission to enter. I allowed her to come in. She sat down and started weeping with me. While we were in the state, Rasulullah ﷺ came and sat down. And he had never sat with me since the day they forged the accusation. No revelation revealed about this. Rasulullah ﷺ comes this time and he sits with her. Now, he recited the tashahud. And then he said, "Oh, Aisha, I have been informed such and such about you. If you are innocent, then Allah will soon reveal your innocence. And if you have committed a sin, then repent to Allah and ask Him to forgive you. For when a person confesses his sin and asks Allah for forgiveness, Allah accepts his repentance. So first of all, it's not talking about confession in front of the people. He's talking to Aisha radiallahu anha to confess to Allah Azza wa Jal, meaning ask for forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we know the rule, even if somebody has committed the sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has covered it, then it's not that you go openly and start talking about the sin, because Allah may forgive you. But there are people, it's also allowed that if somebody is asking for punishment for a sin that a person has committed in this dunya, they can ask for punishment also. So in the akhirah, they will not be punished for the sin. Okay. When Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam finished his speech, Aisha says, "My tears ceased completely, and there remained not even a single drop of it. I requested my father to reply to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." So instead of replying herself, she's asking her father. Abu Bakr doesn't know what to reply. So she said, "I said to my mother, talk to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on my behalf." She said, "By Allah, I do not know what to say to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Aisha said, I was a young girl, did not have much knowledge of the Quran. I said, I know by Allah that you have listened to what people are saying and that has been planted in your minds. And you have taken it as a truth. Now I told you that I am innocent and Allah knows that I'm innocent. You would not believe me if I confess to you falsely that I am guilty. And if I can confess to you falsely that I'm guilty and Allah knows that I am innocent, you would believe me. By Allah, I don't compare my situation with you except the situation of Yusuf's father." So this is interesting. She was so angry that she could not remember the name of Ya'qub alayhi salam. Rather, she just referred to the Ya'qub alayhi salam as the father of Yusuf. And she says, "Fasabrun jameel wallahu al-musta'an ala ma tasifun." So for me, patience is most fitting against that which you assert, and it is Allah alone whose help can be sought. So then Aisha said, and I turned to the other side of my bed, hoping that Allah would prove my innocence. And Aisha says that I never thought Allah would reveal the divine inspiration and the wahi in my case, meaning the Quran, in my favor. And she says that I consider myself too inferior to be taught in the Holy Quran. I hope that Allah's Messenger might have a dream, meaning in which Allah would prove my innocence. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was whatever he was saying or doing was driven by the wahi. And even the ahadith, when we talk about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are part of the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a different kind of a wahi than the Quran, but that's also wahi. It's not verbatim as the Quran is verbatim from Allah Azza wa Jal. So she was hoping that there will be some inspiration to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not hoping that there will be ayat of the Quran will be revealed in her favor. And about 10 ayat were revealed to discuss this issue of Aisha radiallahu anha, the issue of effort. So the hadith goes on. So they overtook him the same state which Rasulullah was overtaken, the same state when the wahi used to come, and the drops of the sweat were dropping like pearls through, though it was cold, wintry day. When that state of Rasulullah was over, he was smiling, and the first word he said, "Aisha, thank Allah, for Allah has declared your innocence." Then Aisha said, "My mother told me, go to Rasulullah," meaning go thank Rasulullah. And Aisha says, "I reply, by Allah, I will not go to him and will not thank him, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thank Rasulullah, but I will thank Allah." So Allah revealed the ayah, "In the ladina ja'u bil ifk, usbatun minkum la tahsabuhu sharra lakum, bal huwa khairul lakum li kulli amrim minhum, maktasaba min al ithm, walladhi tawalla kibrahu minhum, lahu adabun adim." And the rest of the ayat, this is the beginning of the wahi that revealed in her favor. The meaning of ayah is, indeed those who came with falsehood are grouped among you. Do not think it bad for you, rather it is good for you. For every person among them is what punishment he has earned from the sin. And he who took upon himself the greater portion thereof for him is a great punishment. And the ayat continue on. And when Allah gave this declaration, Aisha says, of my innocence, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, who used to provide mistah, he used to provide him provision because he was poor. And Abu Bakr said, by Allah, I will never provide mistah with anything because of what he said about Aisha radiallahu anha. But Allah later revealed, وَلَا يَأْتَنِي أُولُو الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَسَعَةِ أَنْ يُؤْتُوا أُولِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَالْمُهَاجِرِينَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلَا يَعْفُوا وَلَا يَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. And let not those who are good and wealthy among you swear not to help their kinsmen, those in need, and those who left their homes in Allah's cause, let them forgive and overlook. Do you not wish that Allah should forgive you? Verily, Allah is of forgiving, merciful. And when Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu heard of the ayah, after that, Abu Bakr said, yes, by Allah, I like that Allah should forgive me. And he resumed helping Mistah as he used to do before. Now, after that, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Zainab bint Jahash about this situation. And he asked that Zainab bint Jahash, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did you see? She replied, O Rasulullah, I refrain to claim hearing or seeing what I have not heard or seen. By Allah, I know nothing except goodness about Aisha. Aisha further added that Zainab was competing with the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yet Allah protected her from being malicious, for she had piety. Meaning, she's not one of those people who started saying bad things about Aisha, even though her own sister, the sister of Zainab, Hamna, she was one of the people who was flogged. As the riwayat mentioned that there are three people who were involved in slandering Aisha radiallahu anha, including Mistah, Hassan bin Thabit, and Hamna bin Jahash. These three were flogged 80 times, because in Islam, when one person, he makes an accusation towards a man or a woman about zina or these kind of accusations, then do not have the witnesses, four witnesses you are required. Then, if you don't have witnesses and you accuse somebody of these kind of actions, then you will be hit 80 flogs. And this is a had from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that was applied to Mistah Hassan bin Thabit and Hamna bin Jahash. But now the question comes in, is why Abdullah bin Ubai, the one who was the starter of all this, was not flogged. There are two reports. One talks about that he was flogged. The other says, in general, it is mentioned that he was not flogged. And the reason mentioned is because of if you are given the punishment here, then you will not be punished on the day of judgment. That's one of the things. Because then he does not deserve this merit of like the other people. And the other thing is, after that incident that happened, people stopped listening to Abdullah bin Ubayy completely. Whatever he was saying, he was shut up by the people, and they used to stop him saying anything in publicly. And as a matter of fact, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam later on asked Umar bin Khattab about the situation. Don't you see? He said, Umar, if I had Abdullah bin Ubayy killed, a large number of dignitaries would have furiously fight for him. Now, on the contrary, if I ask them to kill him, they will do so out of their own free will. And Umar replied, I swear by Allah, Rasulullah's judgment is much more sound than mine. And after this incident, we find that there were a few small battles that happened around the Medina before Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam headed towards Hudaybiyah, and they were minor ones in the 6th year Hijri. One was headed by Abdurrahman bin Auf. Abdurrahman bin Auf Then that was against the Bani Kelb. And the other one was headed by Ali bin Abi Talib. And that was against Bani Sa'ad bin Bakr. The third one was headed by, there's this difference of opinion, whether it was Abu Bakr Siddiq or Zayd bin Haritha, but that was against Wadi al-Qara in the Ramadan of the 6th Hijri. And the fourth one was by Anas bin Malik, and that was against the tribe of Urayna. And the fifth one by Amr bin, it was reported by, the fifth one is reported by Amr bin Umayyah, Damri, and Salma bin Salame, who have been sent to kill actually Abu Sufyan, the chief of Quraysh, who had already sent a Bedouin to kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But these two men failed, except for the three mushrikeen were killed on this way. So these were the some of the incidents happened after Bani al-Mustaliq. Before Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam headed towards the Hudaybiyah or for the Umrah, and we'll inshallah talk about that. But to remember as a lesson from today's talk, there were a few important points to remember that this idea of nationalism that we can see even among the time of while Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was there among the Sahaba, it was multiple occasions we can see that it was triggered and it was taken care of when the system of Islam was in place and Muslims were reminded of the Aqidah of Islam, and the one who did not follow right away, the state intervened and took care of any of these kind of incidents. And unlike today, that it is very easy for the people to get involved into different kinds of asabiyah or the nationalistic or tribal or racism kind of issues nowadays, even among the Muslims. It's not because Islam is not against it. Yes, Islam is against it. Muslims and individuals are aware of it. But because the system is not there that can impose these thoughts to make sure that that does not trigger any kind of problems among the people. In the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were triggered and they were taken care of. So that's one point of it. Second point is about, we can see that that the kuffar, they realized that they could not win battles or the wars against the Muslims in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and later on. So they took another way of giving bad name to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sahaba and in general Islam by creating a smoke screen in front of Muslims and Islam, so people cannot see what Islam is about, and they just show what they make up stuff against Islam, and that has been going on for a long period of time. So for that, we have to be aware of Islam ourselves, so we can show to the people what Islam is about. So in this case, for example, in the case of Zayd, radiallahu anhu, his marriage to Zainab radiallahu anha, and then after the divorce, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam married to Zainab. This has been used by kuffar a lot to say bad things about the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which are completely false and does not make any sense within if we just read the historical events properly. And about the incident of Aisha radiallahu anha, look, even the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the beloved wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she was not spared of saying bad things about her. But at the end of the day, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even for that, he waited for the wahi and then he acted on this action. So that's another sign of showing that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sahaba, they were very well aware of this thing that our actions are driven by the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they used to wait for the wahi if the rule was not there for a specific situation. And this is what we can see, even the situation where even his whole Rasulullah's own family was under the slander, he still waited for the command of Allah Azza wa Jal in that situation. So inshallah we'll stop here, and if there is any questions or comments on the subject that's covered today, I will answer.
Thank you for listening to this podcast. Podcasts on current events, Islamic guidance, Quran tafsir, and Seerah are available at islampodcasts.com as well as on iTunes. Rate, review, and comment, and let us know how we can grow in our knowledge to better serve our community. Please subscribe, share, and tell a friend about IslamPodcast.com.